incident specifically asked about her doing the welcome, because she's very remarkable. So yes. Let us welcome her as she welcomes you.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And to God be the glory for the things He has done.
Yeah,
amen. As I look around this morning, I see your faces. It just makes me feel real good to know that you came to worship with us.
Amen.
You are at the right place at the right time.
All right.
To receive a blessing. Because our pastor is going to preach.
Yeah.
And we are going to be blessed by God.
Amen.
If you are in this area and want to attend a service that we are having, feel free to come in at any time. Because you're always welcome. If you like what's going on here, tell us. If you don't like it, tell us. To make you feel more comfortable. Again, I'm going to say to you, you are more than welcome to worship with us, because our doors swing on welcome hinges. When our doors are open, come on in.
Amen. Thank the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Excellent. But I thank God for each and every one of you. Having said that, I hope you feel the love that Mount Calvary represents in expressing that to you all. And it comes from a genuine place. So I thank God for that welcome. Amen. At this time, we're going to have another musical selection. And then we're going to have a Thus Saith the Lord. So let us prepare ourselves for the word. Get our heart and mind in the right place. Amen. But the choir will prep us for such a task. Come on, choir.
Well, Miss Perry gave y'all a good welcome, but I'm going to welcome you again, okay?
All right.
We're all gathered here in your presence, Lord, with our arms open wide. We've lifted hands.
Oh,
She knows who she is. She knows who her friend is. So we thank God for that. And the children are doing well. Thank God for the youth that have come to church, that have, and I'm hoping you enjoy yourself at church. Amen?
Amen.
I know that's kind of an unusual statement when you're talking to young people, but I've talked to a few of you guys, and you say y'all enjoy it. So I'm glad you do. So keep on coming. Keep singing in the choir and keep doing what God called you to do in a young age. Amen?
Amen.
Keep on coming. So the deacons, I thank God for them. Deaconess, of course, thank the Lord for their service. My associates, I thank God for them. Thank God for the ushers at the door. Thank God for our security team watching over us. As we pray, they're doing the watching. So we thank God for them. Having said that, auxiliary leaders, let us meet next week, next Sunday, and security team, let's meet two after church. And all the auxiliary leaders, the security team, and deacons, let us meet next week. We've got a few things to go over. But I thank God for the congregation.
Amen.
All of you that have attended in service today, thank God for the choir and them getting us to the gates. Amen.
Amen.
The door's open.
Yes.
And all we need to do now is walk in, okay?
Amen.
They've already opened the door now.
Yes.
So we thank the Lord for that. So let's turn our attention to the book of Romans. And of course, we thank God for the warm welcome Deaconess gave to us this morning. It's always refreshing to have a great greeting. Amen. So thank God for that. Romans, the first chapter, 25th. And I'll read part of the 25th verse. I'll read the first part of it, part A. I'll read the first part of it. Those of us that can stand, let us do so. And those that cannot, let us stand our hearts. Oh yeah, I must confess. You know, sometimes I forget things. And so, sometimes I forget to call deacons up for the welcome, right? Because I'll be, you know, forgetting, too excited. So my wife says, hey, look, won't you put the deacon's name in the bulletin? That way, you will be able to see it, remember.
Amen.
So if y'all didn't notice, the deacon's name was in the bulletin this morning. So, First Lady, I thank God for that. Because sometimes I need some reminders, man. I tell you, I need them. I get ahead of myself sometimes. So I thank God for that. Okay, so the 25th verse. And we'll read that first part there. They exchanged the truth about God for a lie. They exchanged the truth about God for a lie. Father, we're so grateful and humbled by your presence, thankful for your love, thankful for your goodness and your mercy. Thankful for this word, dear Lord God, that you have stylized in my heart. And I ask, O Lord God, that you also pen it upon the spirit of others, dear Lord. Yeah. So we're thankful and we praise your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. This month here, Christmas, is a time that we reflect back on a truth, Jesus' birth. So this morning, for my topic, I want us to focus on this subject. And maybe you've heard these words before. The Spirit of God says there are no alternative facts. There are no alternative facts. Back in January, Ms. Conway, who's the advisor to the president, Kellyanne Conway, she was on Meet the Press. Chuck Todd asked her a question. Well, actually, he was talking to her about the lie that Sean Spicer, the then press secretary, had made about the inaugural, when the president was being inaugurated. He said that the crowds were so big and they were bigger than Barack Obama's. And so Chuck Todd said, well, that's a lie. Kellyanne Conway said, no, he just expressed alternative facts. Todd said, an alternative fact is a lie.
That's right.
A fact is a fact, and anything alternative is a lie. Oh, come on now, sir. But as I was writing this week, the Lord brought this back to me. And he gave me an insight into how the enemy wants to muddy the water. See, the enemy can't deal with the facts. So the enemy wants to create an alternative fact. In hopes that those of us seeking something other can grab that and run with it. Here in Romans, the Apostle Paul is dealing with a group that loves to deal in alternative facts. And he says that they took the truth of God and they exchanged it for a lie. In other words, that which they knew from creation, that which they knew from the preaching of the gospel, that which they knew that scripture had revealed, they took that and they traded it and exchanged it for a lie. But the Spirit of God says there are no alternative facts. And if you choose to trade God's truth for a lie, then that kind of world you're going to live in is a lie also. Oh, we got some folk in here that have traded a few things and have grabbed hold of some lies. But he said that by them doing so, that God gave them over to a lot of things that once were shameful. The Bible declares on that a little bit. He gave them over to shameful lust. Even their women exchanged the natural relationships with other with men and started going out with women. Guys changed the natural use of a woman and started dating men. Trying to make accommodations for folks. conversation sometimes, and we talking, we find out that now, in every profession, people want to accommodate the person. In other words, they don't want to shoot it straight.
All right.
They want to say what's not going to offend you. Because if I offend you, you ain't going to come back, and my boat might have to go back. So now you can come in there and say what you want to take for your whatever you got. You can come in there and say how you feel as far as I think I'm a woman, and they're not going to refute that even though they're looking at you and they can see you a man. But I can't say nothing because they might not come back. But I'm telling you now, whether you come back to Mount Calvary or not, if you in a male body, you a man. If you in a woman body, you a woman. Now, if you don't want to come back, that's on you. But what I'm trying to tell you is, I'm not lost in the alternative fact. I'm standing on the truth of God. I see clearly. I understand what's going on. You got to know that God's word is eternal. And those that try to change it, the Bible says that the rock shall fall on. Trying to muddle the water by creating these alternative facts. If we really thought about it and looked at the time that Jesus Christ was murdered on the cross, and how that when they went to the tomb and the body wasn't there, the enemy stepped in and told the Pharisees and the leaders, just say somebody stole the body. You see what I'm trying to tell you is the enemy was saying, we're going to create an alternative fact. It's true that the body's gone, but it ain't, might not be true that it's resurrected. Let's just say that somebody came by night and stole the body out of the tomb. That's an alternative fact. But I'm telling you now, the witness on the inside says that truth is a lie, that fact is a lie. Why is that? Because the Spirit of God has descended upon us. Renew your faith. Be restored. Be made whole. here at Mount Calvary, to be a member of Mount Calvary, you keep calling this time. Is there one?
Missionary Baptist Church. Are you prepared to vote?
Yes.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed, have the same right? Mm-hmm. Amen. Now, what we'll do is the second Sunday, because I see Sister Brittany out there. Second Sunday in January, we'll start the new members' classes. That way, we have three classes. They'll start at 10 a.m. Three classes. At the end of those three classes, we'll come back. We have one baptism. And then after that, what we'll do is we'll come back. We have the right hand of fellowship. And then we receive in as members. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. Let's give God a hand. Amen.
All right.
Amen. 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 Be blessed. Amen. Hey, you take this word back with you too, because I'm telling you, the way the enemy's working now, he's creating all kind of alternative facts.
Yes.
I'm telling you, he's making the church feel ashamed to even speak the truth now. You know what I mean? Like you have a step with everybody else. Don't get to everybody else.